Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everyone wherever you are. First of all, thank you so much for attending this online session in Database Performance Then and Now by Vivek Sharma. On behalf of Nepal Oracle User Group, I would like to thank Vivek a lot for accepting our invitation. This is going to be a very valuable session, because this session contains how Oracle performance has evolved. Oracle database performance has improved more than 100 times with each release. There was a time when we had a lot of performance issue once data grew more than a GB in a size. Nowadays, table with a few terabyte in a size is not a big deal at all. Last week, I got an opportunity to recover 6 terabyte of single table. And using parallelism, I was able to recover it in just around 2 hours. Amazing, right? As data volume started growing, Oracle database performance has also enhanced with a lot of performance related features. Cost-based optimizer has done a paradigm shift in a performance. Auto undo management, ASMM, AMM, and a lot of our features have contributed to Oracle database performance. Vivek is a technical lead for Oracle Global Leader Program and is a part of Big Data and Data Warehousing product development team. He has over 20 years of experience working on database architecture, consulting, and performance optimization. As an Oracle database expert, he spends most of his time assisting the customer to get best out of their Oracle system and database investment. He assists customers across Asia Pacific on various cloud solutions like Autonomous Database, Exadata Cloud, or with on-premise solution around Oracle engineering system such as Exadata. And as usual, I would like to humbly request everyone to stay mute till the end of the session. You may raise your question via text in the chat section anytime, and we will grab them at the end of the session during Q&A. In the same way, I would like to request everyone to fill up the feedback form, and we will post feedback form URL in the chat window. Next thing, considering the current situation, we would like to request everyone to stay home, stay safe, take care of you and your family. And now, without further ado, I would like to hand over control to Vivek. Vivek will start with his introduction and exciting session. Let's enjoy the session. Vivek, I have made you a presenter now.
Okay. So you all can see my presentation, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And hope I am audible.
Yes, sir, audible.
Okay. Yes, Thank you. Yeah. So thanks, Delhi, for the nice introduction. And you have almost covered many of the topics that actually I wanted to cover in this particular session. So yeah, I mean, database has evolved a lot in last decade or so. And I talk about most of this feature during this 45 minutes to 1 hour. I request everyone to mute yourself because it is disturbing others. Okay, so hello guys, thanks for joining this webinar. As such, I mean, I'm not a big fan of a webinar as it becomes very difficult to interact with the attendees. But at this time of crisis, when the entire world is fighting with this deadly virus, a technical session over the web is the only option. And the show must go on. And therefore, this arrangement of interacting with the technical community is the best way we can have. So thanks for Delhi and Romin for arranging this particular session. And Delhi, can you mute everyone? Unmute everyone. Okay, so yeah, so I was saying hats off to the Nepal Oracle User Group, because it requires much of the effort, much of their personal time arranging these sessions. So a brief introduction. I am Vivek, based in Mumbai. I have been with Oracle for almost 15 years now and have worked under various teams. You know, Oracle is a big organization. So every few years, we get an opportunity to shift from one team to another based on your career path. So currently, I am a part of Oracle Global Leaders Program, where we work for global customers, helping them to get the best out of their Oracle investment, assisting them to move to cloud seamlessly and help them achieve the performance SLAs. This team is basically a part of big data and data warehousing development. So on the screen, you can see my blog URL, where I write about my real life experiences. And I have a Twitter handle as well. So if you have any queries, just tweet it on my Twitter handle, and I would be happy to respond to the queries. So just a safe harbor, okay. Okay, now to set the context, I will talk only about performance. If we talk about Oracle Database as a product, we introduce many features that are specific to high availability or related to backup and recovery, right? Dilly just gave an example where he could recover a 6 terabyte table within 2 hours using the parallelism, right? And that parallelism was Armin parallelism, right? Or the recovery parallelism. But this particular session, I'll only talk about the features related to database and application performance. Secondly, I may not get deep into all the topics. We'll try to cover some of these with explanation and some real life examples. I have to restrict the session to an hour, and this includes a Q&A as well. So please bear with me. Will I cover all the database versions? The answer is no. So I'm definitely not a guy to speak about Oracle 7 or Oracle 8 related features. I can only talk about the database versions that I have worked on. I started my career as an Oracle developer in the year 2000. This is when Oracle 8i was released. And since then, I've seen many of the features that eliminated some or the other bottlenecks or improved some or the other features of the previous versions. So today I'll talk about database versions starting from 8i, 9i, and so on. So let's start. And yes, if you have a question, please post them on chat, and we shall try to take this at the end of the session. In between of my slides, I may ask, and I will ask a couple of questions, and I want everyone to post your answer over the chat so that we can move forward, and I'll respond to the answers as well. Okay, so before we start, right? I mean, just to make this session interactive, I have a couple of questions. Which version of Oracle introduced AWR?
10G.
Oracle 10G?
I think it's better to post your answer over the chat. One request to the attendees, when I say I want the answers, I mean, please post your answer over the chat. Okay, thank you. Yeah, so I can see most of them are responding. Okay, yeah, so the answer is 10G, yes. Which version of Oracle introduced ASSM? Okay, I can see 11GR2. Someone responded 9i. Okay, most of them are responding 11GR2. But yes, the answer is 9i. And what ASSM is? It is Automatic Segment Space Management, right? Until 8i, we used to manage the free list manually. With 9i, we introduced Automatic Segment Space Management, which is the free list will be managed automatically. Even if you add a rack node, the free list groups will be added automatically, right? Which version of Oracle introduced automatic stacks? Ah, 19C, okay. I should have been more specific about it, but anyway, I mean, it was introduced in 10G. So when I say automatic stats, I'm talking about the automatic stats gathering job, right? We introduced it in Oracle Database 10G. What about ASMM? Automatic shared memory management. Okay, 11GR2, 10G, the answer is 10G, yes. What about automatic undo? Fantastic, most of them are responding 9i. Yes, 9i is the correct answer, good. What about bind peaking? Okay, 8i, 10g, 9i, few of them responding 11g. So bind peaking was introduced in 9i, and we'll talk about bind peaking. What about in-memory columnar cache? Yes, it's 12C. Right. What about automatic query rewrite? Okay, many of them responding 12C, few people 9i. But when I talk about automatic query rewrite, I'm talking about, you know, there was a feature implemented in Oracle 8i, which was called as materialized view. It was in version 8i. Okay. What about automatic tuning of DB file multi-block read count? Okay, the answer is 10G. What about automatic memory management? Yeah, many of them, in fact, yeah, the many of them responding 11G. Few of them responding with 10G. The answer is 11G. Finally, function-based indexes. Nine I, 10G, 1% responding with 8I. And the answer is 8I. Right, okay. So let's start. So the very first thing that I would like to talk about is moving from RBO to CBO. Many had a mixed opinion about these two optimizer modes. RBO, which stands for rule-based optimizer, it had many flaws, which CBO addressed. Yes, I mean, initially, there were issues reported with cost-based optimizer as well. And I assume CBO still continues to give nightmares to the DBAs, right? But what I've observed is that in all these years, CBO being more stable with many enhancements and features to augment the inputs to the optimizer. So CBO has evolved a lot, and we'll talk about cost-based optimizer in subsequent slides. RBO, I mean, it's a rule-based optimizer. So it purely works on some set of rules, right? Which says, if I have an index on a column, go ahead and use it. So for example, if I have a query, select star from EMP, where EMP number equal to some value, or say manager equal to some value, right? Now manager is, you know, is a kind of low cardinality column. But then if I have an index on manager column, RBO says, if you have an index, go ahead, use the index. I can give you a real life example. I was working on one particular critical application for one of the largest bank in India. And it was during Oracle 8i. And the application was optimized to work on RBO. Right? It was a rule-based optimizer. There was a particular batch job which used to take around 24 to 36 hours, right? Now, the developers, they wanted me to optimize the code for them. So there was a main cursor query. And while optimizing, I could see that the main cursor query takes a lot of time. I optimized the cursor. I mean, I didn't rewrite the query. The only recommendation from my side was that, okay, it's an RBO. And the RBO says, okay, you have index on particular column, go ahead and use the index. My recommendation would be, since we can't gather statistics, since I mean, it may have a detrimental impact on the entire application, what I suggested is to put a hint of a full table scan. I asked them to force a full table scan in the code for this particular cursor query. The developer responded, I mean, it's a full table scan, it can have a negative impact. So I don't want to take chance. But yes, I had to convince him. He said, okay, I'll go ahead. It will be on you if something goes wrong. Fine. He made the change in the code, full table scan. And you won't believe the code that used to take around 24 to 30 hours, it completed in three and a half hours, right? And the developer then came to me saying that, oh, fantastic. Now probably I know. And going forward, I'll code my application, all my queries to force full table scans. I said, no, I mean, this is not the answer, right? I don't want all the queries to go for a full table scan. So basically the idea was, I mean, RBO purely works on some set of rules. On the other hand, cost-based optimizer, again, as the name implies, right? It purely works on costing model. It goes through the mathematical computation to come out with a cost, right? We all, when we all optimize a query, what we do is we check the cost of a query, and whichever query the cost is least, I mean, we feel, okay, I mean, this query is better than the other queries, right? So it goes through the mathematical computation. which is used to come out with the final plan. Now, some of the challenges with cost-based optimizer in earlier versions were the DBAs used to think, what is the best way of collecting statistics? Which columns needs histogram? And we'll talk about histograms as well. What additional statistics should I gather? And then when should I gather? Right? So we'll talk about this. Before I get into the debate between in and exist, it is important to know that until ATI, we had rule-based optimizer and cost-based optimizer. Once we started moving towards cost-based optimizer, we introduced many transformations, which we call it as query transformations. Now, so query transformation is, a kind of cost-based optimizer. It's a part of cost-based optimizer. So now there are many query transformations like join elimination, simple view merging, right? The goal of a query transformation is to rewrite a query from one form to another for faster execution. Some of these transformations are cost-based, and some of these are heuristic-based, which we call as rule-based, right? So when I say rule-based, it is not a part of rule-based optimizer. Query transformation is a part of cost-based optimizer, but few transformations are cost-based. So what transformation does is, the job of the query transformer is to rewrite the query. And when the optimizer rewrites the query, each query has to go through the cost-based model, right? And whichever cost is better, query transformation will use that particular query, rewritten query, and will execute the query on behalf of the end user, right? So this particular query transformation is cost-based. There are a couple of transformations which are rule-based, which says, the query has written. So for example, if I take in and exist, right? Until ATI, in and exist, it raised a serious debate on which is better and which to use when. As a part of query transformation, starting 9i, in and exist are automatically transformed into semi-join, right? And this particular transformation is not cost-based, it is rule-based. So if you write a query using in, or if you write a query using exist, the query will be automatically transformed into a semi-join. So it's a rule-based query transformation. Not in and not exist are both functionally different. In null values can cause the queries to return wrong results, right? So they are not equal. Hence, for a row source with null values, not exist was used, and for not null, not in could be used. For not in and not exist, has join NT had been available since Oracle 7. However, apart from the functional issue due to the presence of null, the performance characteristics of not in and not exist are different as well. So therefore, in Oracle 11G, we introduced null-aware anti-join, which was again a rule-based query transformation. So starting Oracle 10G plus, if you write a query with not in and not exist, the query will be transformed automatically, and again this transformation will be rule-based. Then we move from literals to bind, right? The idea behind bind was scalable application, right? So for any scalable application, and particularly for an OLTP application, there used to be a strong recommendation to use bind variables instead of literals. This is to avoid parsing overhead. So if every query in my application is unique only because of the search value, then all these queries have to go through hard parsing, which means the entire step of syntax check, the semantic check, then to the generation of execution plan. All these are CPU intensive. So the very first recommendation was to use bind variables. In Oracle 8i, we introduced cursor sharing parameter for the applications that can't be optimized overnight. That is, modifying the application to make use of bind variables needed some time, right? So cursor sharing was introduced in A type. We had two values then, exec, that was default, and four. Then in 9i, we introduced the third value, similar, which addressed some of the drawbacks of four. One of the side effects of using bind variables in Oracle A type was that optimizer used to come out with the cardinality calculation based on default. Now, what is cardinality? Cardinality means the expected number of rows from a table or a row source based on query predicate. Now, for bind variables in Oracle A type, the defaults were 1% for equality predicate, 5% for less than or greater than, and for between predicate, it was 0.25%. So many a times, these default values used to generate suboptimal plan. And we all know that accurate cardinality calculation is critical to come out with optimal join method and join order. Therefore, in 9i, we introduced bind peaking to address the issues due to default cardinality calculation. Now, bind peaking means the optimizer used to peek into the value of the bind variables, and based on the value, it used to calculate nearly accurate cardinality, right? But there were another flaw with bind peaking, right? Now, with bind peaking, what we did was, so if you run a query, if I have a column say gender, which is male and female, and if I run a query select star from EMP where gender equal to colon B1, right? Now my male, I may have the data distribution which says male is 95% and female is 5%, or say male is 98, female is 2%. I have an index on gender column. So until A-type it was, if I execute a query select star from EMP where gender equal to colon B1, and if I pass a value female to B1, it used to say, okay, it's a bind variable, go for a full table scan based on the default value, right? With 9i, what we did, we introduced bind peaking, which says, okay, peek into the value of the bind variable. Now, when you peek into the bind variable, it says, okay, the value is female, and female is only 2% of my total data. Go for an index scan, right? If the value of bind variable is male, okay, it is 98%, go for a full table scan. Now, the flaw with bind peaking was first cursor always win, which is if I execute a query, select star from EMP where gender equal to colon B1, and if I pass a value female to B1, it says, okay, female is 2%, go for index, fine. Once the query is hard passed with an index scan, subsequent execution of the same query will use an index scan, even if you pass a value male to the query. So this says first cursor always win. Next day, say the cursor is aged out of the shared pool. If you run the query with say a bind variable value as male, okay, the optimizer will come out with the plan, full table scan, and any subsequent execution of the same query will use a full table scan even if you pass the value as female, right? So this was the flaw with bind peaking, which says first cursor always wins. Then in 11g we introduced something called as adaptive cursor sharing. Now what is adaptive cursor sharing? It is, okay, you execute a query with female with colon b1, pass the value female, it will come out with the plan as index scan. Subsequent execution, even if it's you execute it using male, it will be an index scan. It says, okay, previously the plan was passed with index scan. Okay, but Oracle will internally monitor the performance of the query, and it says, okay, with male it should have been a full table scan. The third execution with male, or the second execution rather, the second execution with male, it will be a full table scan. So I'll have two child cursor, one child cursor for female and another child cursor for male, index scan for female and full table scan for male. So I'll have multiple plans in my cursor cache. right? So this, so we address the flaw with bind picking with adaptive cursor sharing. So someone has asked me, give some examples of bind variable, right? So bind variable is, if you run a query, select star from EMP where EMP number equal to 1234, right? EMP number is nearly unique. So if I have an application which says, run the query with literal, select star from EMP, where EMP number equal to 1234, select, someone else executes the same query with select star from EMP, where EMP number equal to 5678, right? I'm passing literal values. So for Oracle, all these queries are unique queries. So all these queries have to be parsed, hard parsed every time these are executed, right? Because they differ in the literal value, even though the plan of all these queries would be same, right? But since because of the literal value, all these plans would be different. So therefore, the queries should be hard parsed every time these are executed. Therefore, the recommendation from our side was use bind variable so that if I execute a query, select star from EMP where EMP number equal to colon B1, it will be hard passed only first time, and subsequent execution will be short passed or will be used from the cursor cache. Okay. Now, with the introduction of bind peaking and adaptive cursor sharing, right? This also means, right now, when you I have seen many people, they still optimize the query by way of extend plan for, right? So the traditional way of generating your plan by way of extend plan or set auto trace, your plan may or may not match with the actual runtime plan, right? I'll talk about it in the subsequent slide. One point that I missed here is that with 12c, we are back to two parameters, that is exec, which continues to be default, and force, right? Similar is deprecated, right? So we have only exec and force. And one strong recommendation from my side would be exec being a default is the optimal value. The value force is only to be used as a temporary solution. As I said earlier, if I can't modify the application overnight, right? The application team needs some time to implement bind variables. So till the time they take or they optimize their application, you can make use of force, but exec would be a ideal solution. The exec would be a default, the default parameter exec would be a better solution because force definitely will have some impact on the CPU utilization, right? So coming back to the bind picking. So due to the bind picking and adaptive cursor sharing, my recommendation, never optimize a query based on explain plan for and auto trace, right? Instead use dbms underscore explain dot display underscore cursor. This will give you the actual runtime plan of the query, right? Reason being, we don't peek into the bind variable when we actually check the plan using explain plan for. So explain plan for will not peek into the bind variable. So if you have an application which uses bind variable, it is always better to use dbms underscore explain dot display underscore cursor. Can we make use of cursor sharing at session level? Yes. Okay. Then we move from manual memory management to automatic, which managed some of the SGA components automatically based on the workload. Before this was introduced, DBAs used to struggle with the sizing, right? Sizing of the buffer cache and the shared pool, especially in cases when the databases were used to manage different workloads. Again, in the initial releases, automatic shared memory management had few bugs, but as we moved from version to version, the ability to size these memory areas is much more stabilized. Our own autonomous database, right? We provide performance and availability SLAs. We use automatic memory management, and it has been working absolutely fine. Again, this is now a thing of past, right? I still recollect my very first Oracle database creation task on a Windows server when I moved from developer to DBA. So whenever I used to create an Oracle database, I mean, this was in the year 2001, I had to create a document with the, you know, with the details of the disk drive that can be used for data, the separate set of drives for indexes and temporary segments and so on, right? Then we used to create multiple table spaces to segregate data and indexes into different table space, else it can have a detrimental impact on my performance, right? With ASN and with the latest storage enhancement, now these are things of past. You may want to segregate objects based on their size or some other parameters, but that would be purely for manageability reason, but definitely not for performance, right? In our autonomous database, we create only single table space, and this single table space is used for table data and indexes. We don't create multiple table spaces, right? So again, these are things of past. Now, most of the shared pool is protected by mutexes. Latches had a certain restriction on limitations. Latches were fixed in number. So in case of shared pool, the number of library cache latches were fixed to next prime number to the number of CPUs. This means if you have a database with 32 CPUs, the number of library cache latches would be 37. This limit impacted the performance of a highly concurrent environment. Further, latches also had issues with false contention. To improve the scalability and reduce contention, we introduced mutexes, which are lightweight than latches. This means less code path, so less CPU cycle, and they consume less memory, around 24 bytes against 128 bytes of latches, and they are dynamically created, right? So as Dilly mentioned right in the start, that volume has gone up, the concurrency has gone up, right? Therefore, we felt, yeah, with the limitation with the number of latches, definitely we may not be able to address the concurrency requirement of a highly OLTP application. We moved from latches to mutexes. The other feature that I have not listed on this particular slide is the log generation, right? We introduced in-memory and undo to reduce contention on latches related to redo writes. We introduced redo allocation latch, right, which was responsible to allocate the log buffer, space in the log buffer. And redo allocation latch was a kind of, a single point of contention. Starting 10G, what we introduced was a private strands and in-memory undo to reduce contention on redo allocation latches, right? Okay. Which version of Oracle introduced filter? If you can post your answer on chat, which version of Oracle introduced Bloom filters? Okay, 10G, 99. Okay. Okay, I can see a few. Okay. So few of them have responded 10G. Answer is correct. It was in 10G. Okay. And now Bloom filter is used for which of these features? Is it used for parallel joins? Is it used for join filter pruning, result cache? None of the above or all of the above? Okay, join. Come on. I need the answer. I can see only one answer. Okay, join filter in parallel. Okay, Exadata. Okay, all of the above, all of the above. Okay, think all right. The answer is all of the above. So Bloom filter was introduced in 10G, right? It was introduced in 10G and was only limited to parallel queries. That in 10G, it was only restricted to parallel queries. Starting 11G, we started implementing it for other features as well. So the benefit of Bloom filter was the reduction in the amount of data that is sent across the parallel slaves, right? This was in 10G. With 11G, the use of Bloom filter was extended to join filter pruning, which I'll talk about. Result cache, which was again in 11G, and Exadata storage indexes, right? Exadata storage indexes use Bloom filter to check for the existence of the data stored on the storage layer, right? So Exadata storage indexes as well use Bloom filter. So basically Bloom filter optimizes the resource intensive hash joins by reducing the amount of memory used, right? They purely work on probabilistic algorithm that use less memory to support membership queries. So let's go through an example. So if I run a query, select star from T1 comma T2, where I have a join on A, column A, and a filter predicate on T1, which is T1B equal to 100, right? Without a Bloom filter, table T1 will be scanned, right? I have a where predicate, I have a filter predicate on T1. So table T1 will be scanned. Rows for T1 dot B equal to 100 will be filtered, right? Then table T2 will be joined to T1. And finally, the rows that matches the T1 A equal to T2 will pass through. Other rows would be eliminated, right? So it has to go through the entire step of, you know, it has to prune a large number of rows, right? With Bloom filter, the table T1 will be scanned. Rows pertaining to table T1 dot B equal to 100 is filtered, and a Bloom filter is created for table T1. Then table T2 is scanned, and then the Bloom filter, which was created in step number 2, is sent as a filter predicate to T2, right? So you can see, I mean, it eliminates the number of rows faster than hash join. So hash join has to go through all the join condition and has to filter out, eliminate the rows at step number 4. With Bloom filter, the filter predicate, the Bloom filter that we create at step number 2, is sent as a kind of as a filter predicate to T2, and it eliminates the rows much faster, consuming less memory than hash join, right? So Bloom filter is much faster than a traditional hash join, right? Then we move from OLTP to data warehouse to mixed workload, right? Now, you know, I mean, gone are the days when we say my application is a pure OLTP application, right? Five years back or 10 years back, what the customer used to do was they have an OLTP application. They want reporting to be run. So what they used to do is they used to create a separate instance where they used to run the reports, right? Now, since we need real-time reporting, right? What we do is we run the report directly on OLTP, but we want to make sure that it doesn't have an impact on my database performance, right? So what we introduced in 12C release 1, and to be more specific, release 12.102, we introduced something called as in-memory columnar database, right? Or in-memory columnar store, right? With this, Oracle allowed data to be stored in row format on disk, right? The way we store right now, row format on disk, and in the buffer cache, as well as in the columnar format in the in-memory area, right? Both at the same time. So my traditional queries, my DMLs, my traditional queries with the Unix scan, primary key scan, will go to the buffer cache to the row format, and my analytical queries can go to the in-memory columnar area, right? So access from the in-memory column area would be definitely faster because the data is stored in the columnar format, right? And all these are transparent to the application, right? And they come under the purview of Oracle Optimizer. Then manual to automation and more and more automation, right? We are working towards more automation, and some of these leverage machine learning techniques. So for example, auto indexing, where we leverage reinforcement algorithm to ensure that indexes created by this 19c feature does not impact other application workload. Then we introduced automatic SQL management to ensure your critical application queries are not regressed due to any change at the database layer. And then in 9i, we also introduced something called as incremental statistics, right, for conventional DMLs. Okay, a quick question. Which query would you prefer to count the number of rows in a table? Will it be select count ename from EMP, select count star from EMP? Whether the answer is it depends or no difference. Okay. I can see many of them responding query number one. Some of them say no difference. Okay. My answer to this would be it depends, right? So let's go through an example, right? So I have a table, right? I have a table T1, and if you see, there are two columns which are object ID N, which is in red, and object ID NN, which is purple color, right? Now, the difference between these two columns are object ID N. N stands for null. So I have a couple of null values in object ID N. Object ID NN is a not null, right? So I have a not null constraint on this particular column, right? I create a bitmap index on temporary column. So object ID N. So if you see the value that I have populated to the two columns, object ID N and object ID NN, is exactly same. You see the select statement, right? Object ID, right? Object name. Okay, the column name should have been, right? Okay, it is object ID, right? There's a mistake in the query. It should be select owner object ID, comma object ID. Okay. So fine. So object ID N has null values. Object ID underscore NN has a not null constraint, and therefore all the values are not null. Then I have an index, bitmap index on temporary column, right? Ironic query, select count object name underscore N from T1. It goes for a full double scan. And select count of object name underscore NN, it goes for an index scan, right? But if you see, the index that I have is on temporary column, right? But my second query, there's no temporary column in the query. Even then, it is using an index on temporary. Why? Any guesses? Same query, same statistics, right? The first query goes for a full double scan. The second query is doing an index scan. And that too, an index on a column which is not part of my query. indexes cannot be used for verifying null values, right? Indexes do not store null. Okay, but in this case, you know, it's a bitmap index. Bitmap index will store null as well. But anyway, okay. Now, this is the answer, right? If you see the if you extract the 153 trace for both the queries, right? Now the difference here is now in the first query it is doing a full table scan. It says count star. So it is basically going through a transformation phase. It says count to count star not done, right? Because I don't have any constraint, right? In the second case, as I said earlier, right, I had a constraint on object name and, right? So it says converting count of object name and to count star, right? The reason it used a temporary index in this particular case was the query was transferred. It said, okay, I have an index on temporary column. I have a bitmap index on temporary column, right? And there's a not null constraint on object name and, which means, yes, I can transform the query. So instead of executing count of object name and, let me transform the query to count star, right? And since now it is count star, and star means temporary column as well, I can very well make use of the temporary index, right? So few transformations are dependent on constraint, right? So this example also says, right, the important to have constraints, right? Okay, another question. With respect to Exadata, what are the difference between a traditional full table scan and smart scan? So I'll not get deep into Exadata because it is not like, I mean, it's a user group event. I don't want to promote Exadata, but yes, since Exadata has evolved a lot from version V1 to the X8, and currently we are in X8M as well. So I thought I'll talk briefly about Exadata as well. Okay, so a smart scan can use storage indexes, okay? Okay. Okay, with respect to Exadata, right? Select A comma B from X, Y, Z, where X equal to B1, right? It's a bind variable. I don't have an index on X. Will it go for a traditional full table scan? Or will it go for a smart scan? Or is the answer, it depends. Okay, it depends, right? Okay, so in the interest of time, I'll directly answer this particular query. The answer is, it depends, right? Not all full table scans are smart scans, right? Not all full table scans are smart scans. You need to make a note of it. Whether to go for a smart scan or a full table scan. Now, full table scan is an optimizer plan. Optimizer comes out with a plan, says that, okay, since there are no indexes, go for a full table scan, right? Now whether this full table scan translates into a traditional full table scan, which is, you know, read the blocks from the disk to the buffer cache, right? Or whether to go for a smart scan, wherein we directly retrieve the rows of interest from the storage to the compute node. So whether to go for a traditional full table scan or smart scan, it is dependent purely on the size of your table, right? Which is, if my table size is more than 2% the size of my buffer cache, only then it will go for a smart scan. If my tables are smaller than 2% the size of my buffer cache, it will go for a traditional full table scan, right? So as I said, I'll not get deep dive into Exadata, okay? But I thought This is important to discuss about Exadata as well, because I still recollect the very first implementation of Exadata, the very first Exadata in one of my customer in India, the very first implementation. The customer complaint there was that Exadata V1, I mean, it was, you know, I think 16 CPUs with 96 GB of RAM per node. The customer complaint was that, Vivek, I have good amount of CPU. My CPU utilization is just 10%, 20%, that I have 80% headroom, but the amount of memory is 100% consumed. I can't add more number of database, right? Now, I mean, we started with X2, X3, X4, and now with X8, I mean, you have good amount of CPU, the good amount of flash cache, good amount of memory as well, right? You can go up to 748 GB per node, right? V1 was purely a kind of, you know, data warehouse type of Exadata machine. We have implemented a couple of features, and I'll talk about those in this particular slide, right? So, I'll talk about a couple of now everyone knows, right, what query offload is, right? It is a smart scan, right? So let's talk about in-memory OLTP and consolidation, the accelerated feature, right? Now, Exadata storage software, it adds a new memory cache in front of the flash memory, right? Now, I'm talking about OLTP, right? Now, how it improves the OLTP performance, right? Now, the speed to read the data from the new memory cache, which is in front of the flash memory, is 100 microseconds. The speed to read the data from flash cache is 250 microseconds, right? So the reading from this new memory cache is 2.5 times faster than reading from the flash cache. So this new memory cache is a small memory area which acts as an extension to the database buffer cache. Now, extension means a block that is evicted from the buffer cache is moved to this particular new memory area, right? So if a database buffer cache needs the block again, it can read from this RAM cache, which is otherwise read from the flash memory. It does improve the IO latency by 2.5 times, right? In-memory columnar, right? We briefly spoke about in-memory columnar cache in one of my previous slides. This in-memory columnar cache is a part of SGA and therefore limited to the size of the SGA. With Exadata Software 18c, you can now have uncompressed or OLTP compressed tables populated on the flash cache in columnar format, right? So the benefit of this approach is smart scans for these tables can leverage the benefit of in-memory like vector processing, Bloom filters, etc. Now, this gives you an added benefit of larger in-memory area, right? Wherein you keep your performance sensitive tables or partitions in memory in the SGA and other tables or partitions on the flash cache, right? Then we have a smart fusion block transfer. What is the topmost IO for a typical OLTP application? Any idea? It is redo write, right? Log writer, the performance of the log writer, right? The writes to the redo log files have to be fast, else it will have a negative impact on the scalability of my OLTP application, right? So many OLTP workloads can have hot blocks that need to be updated frequently across multiple nodes in an Oracle rack, right? So example being write growing index, right? Where new rows are added to a table with an index from several Oracle rack nodes, right? The index leaf block in this case becomes a hot block, right? So for example, I have a two node rack and my node two wants block A, which is in node one, right? With smart block fusion block transfer, right? The benefit of this particular feature is, now without, so let's talk about what happens if I am on a traditional rack node, right? On a traditional rack node, if I need block A, if node two needs block A, which is on node one, and modified at node one will have to flush the changes to the log from the log buffer to the ready log, right? Once the changes are written to disk, only then it can send the block to node two via interconnect, right? So there's some sort of latency involved, right? With smart fusion block transfer, this latency of ready log write at the sending node is eliminated, right? The block is transferred as soon as the IO to the ready log is initiated by the sender, which means my node one will send the write the changes to the disk, but simultaneously it will send the block to the requesting node as well. So the write latency is eliminated, and it improves the performance of an application. Okay, just a quick question. I mean, in the interest of time, I would like to move as fast as possible because I have a couple of slides. Which version of Oracle introduced top frequency and hybrid histogram? Quick.
Sorry, could you please repeat?
The question is, which version of Oracle introduced top frequency and hybrid histogram?
12C.
Yeah. Answer is 12C. And what is the mandatory preference? Right. What is the mandatory preference and its value to ensure that these two statistics are collected? It is estimate percent equal to auto sample size. Right. Okay. Now, let me get into the optimizer. Okay. So we briefly spoke about cost-based optimizer, right? Now let's get into this critical part of the database kernel and how it evolved, right? Cost-based optimizer was introduced in Oracle 7. And since then, we have added many new features. Some of these features were to address the shortfalls, and some of these were a kind of new introduction, right? So as a part of query cost-based transformation, cost-based optimizer, we introduced query transformation, that is rewrite the query to come out with a better plan, right? We briefly spoke about query transformation. We spoke about bind picking, right, which was introduced to address the flaw with the optimizer when it comes to default calculation of the cardinality, which is 1% for equality and 5% for range predicate, right? We spoke about it. In 9A release 2, we introduced dynamic sampling to augment the statistics in case these were either missing or stale or were not good enough to generate an optimal plan. Then in 11G, as a part of adaptive feature, we introduced adaptive cluster sharing, right? This feature addresses some of the shortfalls of bind picking, which we spoke about, right? Until 10G, the plan once generated was always reused on a soft parse, right? So if there were cardinality misestimates, there was no mechanism for the optimizer to automatically detect these and fix the misestimates, right? Starting 11G, we introduced something called as cardinality feedback, which provided the optimizer with the post-execution statistics as well, which optimizer used to come out with an optimal plan based on the post-execution statistics. So even if the cursor was hard passed, it was then the cursor cache, optimizer could use the learnings from the past execution, right? And then we move towards more dynamic plan and towards more adaptation, right? With 12C, and we'll talk about it in subsequent slide, right? One of the drawbacks of 11G, right? When we spoke about cardinality feedback, right? One of the drawbacks of 11G was that fixes based based on the learnings were not persistent, right? Now take for example, coordinated feedback. During the execution of the query, it collects the important statistics of the calculated cardinality, the one that was generated by the optimizer, right? And the actual cardinality, which are the actual number of rows returned, right? Returned at runtime, right? Based on this learning, the subsequent execution can adapt to a new plan, right? But the challenge here was, what if the cursor is aged out of the shared pool? The optimizer has to go through the bad estimate all again, right? It will come out with the best bad estimation. It has to go through again the learning at the execution time, right? So the problem with 11G was that the fixes were not persistent. If the cursor is aged out, the optimizer has to go through all the pain again, right? This is addressed in 12C, and we shall talk about it in subsequent slides. So let's get into the optimizer part, the optimizer building block, right? A user submits a SQL, right? Which is then sent to the query optimizer. Okay, it could any query, it has to go through the query optimizer, right? So it goes to the query optimizer. Now the inputs to the query optimizers are the object level statistics, which are the table level, the index level, the number of rows in the table, the number of blocks, the number of distinct values, the data distribution, right? Then the system statistics, which are basically my hardware layer statistics like CPU speed, the IO speed, right? Then the database design, which is my indexes, whether I have indexes on the columns, whether I have metallized views, right? So these are my database design. Then fixed plans like SQL plan management, and I'll talk about it in a moment, right? Then the execution environment, like my optimizer parameters, optimizer index caching, optimizer index cost ADJ, right? All these are my optimizer related parameters. Then the values of bind variable, right? Especially if the data is skew, right? Data is non-uniform, gender equal to male, female, right? The data is basically non-uniform. Then dynamic sampling that provides the additional statistics. Cardinality feedback, which is the learning based on the cardinality misestimate. So all these are fed to the optimizer, and then optimizer comes up with an execution plan, right? This is until 11G, right? This is until 11G. With 12C, we introduced two new features which are called as adaptive query optimization. So within adaptive query optimization, we have adaptive plans and adaptive statistics. So let's first talk about adaptive query optimization, and then I'll come back to this particular slide. So this is the diagram, the flow of the query. So when a user or a DB application submits a SQL statement, right, it has to go through the parsing step, which is the syntax, the semantics check, right? Then it has to go to the query transformation. We spoke about query transformer, right? So when the query is transformed, the plan for the queries are generated, and each of the query has to go through the cost estimator, right? So whichever query is better, right? Then the code the costing mechanism is done. On the right hand side of the screen, you can see the other inputs like the statistics, right? The DBA generate the statistics, right? The statistics, the SQL, so whether I have the SQL plan management for a particular query, whether I have fixed the query, right? So all these inputs goes through the query transformation, the SQL compiler, right? So the very first stage, right? So the very first stage, okay? The very first stage is at the, so when we talk about plan adaptation, right? The very first stage is at the at the planned compile time, right? So during planned compilation, if the optimizer feels that we have not collected enough statistics, or these are stale, or the query predicates are so complex that whatever statistics we have cannot calculate the accurate cardinality, then we will try to supplement whatever we have with additional adaptation, right? This we call as dynamic statistics. And then we can also do the adaptation during the execution phase. So once you have picked the plan, and during the execution, if the optimizer sees that it has done a mistake and is executing a bad plan, for example, based on the cardinality estimates, I may have chosen a wrong join method or a distribution method for parallel queries and so on, I can switch the plan or distribution method at the time of execution. This feature is called an optimizer adaptive plans. Now, when I say join method, right now, one of the benefit of adaptive plan is, now if my optimizer has come up with the plan, say nested loop join, right? But at runtime, optimizer says, okay, while I have generated the plan which is nested loop join, I think hash join would have been a better choice. Optimizer can change the plan at runtime, right? It can change the plan from nested loop join to hash join at runtime, right? And vice versa as well. I mean, if the plan is hash join, it can change from hash join to nested loop join as well. So I can adapt the plan at runtime, right? So this was my adaptive plan. And finally, the adaptation can be done after execution, right? Again, I mean, if you did some mistake in your cardinality misestimate, at the end of the query execution, you compare the actual cardinalities to the estimated cardinalities, and we have a mechanism to feedback this information to the optimizer, so that next time the same statement is being optimized, you will not make the same mistake, right? This feature is called as cardinality feedback and SQL plan directive, right? So cardinality feedback, SQL plan directives, and dynamic statistics are part of my optimizer adaptive statistics, right? So, and if you see in this particular diagram, right, there is a red arrow from execution to cursor cache and back to plan generator. So which means even if the plan is generated, even if the execution is completed, we can learn from the mistakes and we can pass all this information back to the query query optimizer to come out with the optimal plan. Now coming back to this particular diagram, right? What are the difference between adaptive plan and adaptive statistics, right? Both learn from the mistakes and adapt to a better plan, right? However, the difference between the two is that adaptive plans can switch the join methods, right? If there are cardinality misestimates, right? Join order. So as I explained earlier, right? So if my plan is nested loop join, at runtime, if I feel, yeah, nested loop join is not an optimal plan, I can switch from nested loop join to hash join. I can switch from hash join to nested loop join, right? So nested loop to hash join or hash join to nested. So I can change the join method, right? But what about join order, right? If I switch from nested loop join to hash join, right? I can't change the join order, right? If my A is a driving table, I can't change B to be my driving table, right? This is where my adaptive statistics comes into play, right? My adaptive statistics, based on the learning, it says, okay, the plan was my A was a driving table, but now if I see the estimate, my B should have been a driving table. I can switch the join order at subsequent execution, and this is called my adaptive statistics, right? And all these statistics are flushed to disk to make sure that these are persistent and are fed back to the optimizer by way of SQL plan directives, right? So you can see there is a two-way arrow between the query execution plan and the adaptive query optimization, right? So until 11G, it was query optimizer, the statistics, the database design, and finally the query execution plan. Starting 12C, we generate the SQL plan directives, we learn from the mistakes, and we pass all the information back to the optimizer, right? Okay. Now, so optimizer adaptive feature, this particular feature was introduced. Now, how driving table is decided? Now, this is a huge topic, right? I mean, difficult to cover in this particular session, but basically the driving table is decided based on the number of rows. So the idea is my driving table should fetch less number of rows, right? I mean, it depends on the join condition, the nested loop join or the hash join. So in case of nested loop join, my outer table, if I have an index. So basically, I mean, optimizer will decide based on the statistics, based on the database design. Okay. So optimizer adaptive feature was introduced in 12C release 1. And this particular parameter defaults to true, right? By default, it is true. And the single parameter controls the adaptive plans and adaptive statistics. So the two features, right? Adaptive plans and adaptive statistics, right? With 12CR2, we, instead of one single parameter, we introduced two parameters, the optimizer adaptive plan, which defaults to true, and optimizer adaptive feature statistics, which defaults to false, right? This is based on the number of issues reported by the customers, right? We saw that, okay, I mean, adaptive statistics is causing most of the issues with the adaptive optimizer. We thought, okay, let's make this parameter default to false, and let's keep adaptive plan to true. So this was in 12CR2. So we introduced two parameters, the adaptive plan and adaptive statistics. Now, you can backport these two parameters to 12CR1 by way of this particular fix control, which is 2666-4361 and a patch, right? So if you apply this particular patch and the fix control in 12CR1, so instead of one single parameter, you'll have two parameters to control the adaptive feature. Okay. So automatic statistics, right? We introduced in 10G. So accurate quadratic calculation is very critical, right? It, as it dictates the access path for join queries, and for join queries like join methods, join method and join order. Now, for cardinality, it is important to have accurate or nearly accurate value for number of distinct values. So therefore, with 10G, we introduced automatic stats gathering to ensure that the statistics are up to date. We also introduced a dictionary view call underscore usage dollar, which is populated with the information on the columns that are used in query predicates. This information helps optimizer in deciding which column to gather histograms and which column doesn't require histogram. So when you gather statistics, it is easier to calculate number of rows, the minimum value and the maximum value for a particular column, but it is very time consuming to calculate the distinct values. So before 11G, we used to sample the data, and the way this sampling used to work, it used to take some sample of rows from some randomly selected block. If we are lucky, we would get nearly accurate number of distinct values. But what about the cases where we have some critical values missing from the sample? So how do we extrapolate the number of distinct value, right? The challenge was, how do we extrapolate? With 11G, we introduced synopsis that stores one row per distinct value per table column. So these synopsis are stored in CSOX table space. So with 12C, we introduced a better and space saving option, which is hyperlog lock, that works on the probabilistic algorithm. So we have a preference approximate underscore NDV underscore algorithm that can be set to to switch between the synopsis and the HL. I mean, you can have both the synopsis as well as the new algorithm. As I said, right, HLL, it's a data structure which it purely works on probabilistic data structure. It is used to estimate the cardinality of the data set. It consumes less memory and estimates nearly accurate cardinality. And the accuracy is around 95% to 97%, and is a faster option, especially for large volume of data, right? Then with 11G, we introduced, you know, index statistics. When you create the index, when you create the indexes, the statistics will be generated at runtime. And with 12C, we introduced the same feature for tables as well. So with so when you load the data using direct path load or direct path insert, the statistics will be gathered automatically for the table. Right, with 19C, right, we have introduced something called as statistic generated for conventional database as well. Right, statistics on global temperature table, right? Until 11G, the statistics that you gather for the global temperature tables were shared by all the session, right? Now, those statistics may or may not be relevant for other session, right? Because global temperature tables are, you know, transient tables, right? With 12C, we introduced something called as, you know, which is controlled by way of a preference global temp table stats, right? Now, you can set this particular preference. One second, I'm facing a problem. Just hold on. Yeah, I'm sorry about it. Yeah, so with 12C, you can set this particular preference, right? And which means the statistics that you gather at the session level will only be used for your particular. I don't know. One second. I'll stop the sharing for a moment. Sorry about it. Yeah, so with 12C, I'm sorry about it. Yeah, so with 12C, what we introduced is a preference global time table stats, right? So you can control whether you want the statistics to be the global temporary statistic to be shared by all the session, right, which is the 11G behavior, or you want these statistics to be private to your particular session, right? So this is the enhancement in 12C, right? Then we introduced something called as extended statistics in which was in 10G, right? In 11G, you can collect extended statistics manually by way of seed columns column usage. Now, what is extended statistics? Let's talk about this briefly. So extended statistics are, I mean, I need the statistics for dependent columns. So for example, if I run a query, right? If I run a query, select star from EMP where country equal to Nepal and city equal to Kathmandu, right? I know, I mean, this particular query will fetch a couple of rows, right? But what if I execute a query which says select star from EMP where country equal to Nepal and city equal to Mumbai, right? There will be zero rows. You know, I know, right? But for optimizer doesn't know that that Mumbai and Nepal, they are, I mean, completely different, right? Mumbai is in India, right? So how do we fetch this particular information to the optimizer? So this is where extended statistics comes into play, right? So extended statistics is I collect the statistics for dependent columns. So in this case, my country and city, these two columns are dependent, right? So optimizer will come out with the current calculation based on the dependence, based on the extended statistics, right? These are very critical. Otherwise, I mean, optimizer will come out with the suboptimal plan. So extended statistics are very critical. So with 11G, seed call usage is the preference you can use to collect the statistics. With 12C, it is automatic. Once you set the auto stat extension preference, your extended statistics will be automatically collected, but it is manual by default, right? Okay, now a question over here. Identify the parallelism used by the query. So what will be the number of parallelism used by query number one on the query at the left-hand side? 4, okay. I've set the parallelism to 2 at the session level, but my query says 4. What about right-hand side? Query at right hand side. It could be 8, okay. The answer is yes. For left hand side, it will be 4. For right hand side, it will be 8. And biggest one wins. Right? Okay, now let's talk about parallelism, right? Why parallelism? Basically for performance, right? I mean, I have a big table. I have to improve the performance. If I run a query on a big table, and for better performance, what I do is I run the query to spawn parallel processes, right? So basically it's a divide and rule. So what I do is I divide a large table into a smaller chunk, right? And then I execute the query on the smaller chunks, and finally I combine the results. So divide and rule. Efficient use of resources, right? And degree of parallelism of a query is computed by the optimizer at the time of the hard pass. It cannot be changed post execution. So once my query starts, I can't change my parallelism from 8 to 16 or 16 to 8, right? Once the query starts. So degree of parallelism is set by the optimizer pre-execution, right? Manual degree of parallelism, the developer or the DBA decide the parallelism at the statement level or the object level, right? You can set the degree of parallelism at the object level as well. But basically what we do is we use the hint to run the parallel queries. We have seen in the previous example, select parallel hint, right? What if I have a query, I have a database with 16 OCPUs, but a developer runs a query with say parallelism 64. Right? So it will definitely slow down the entire system, right? So there was a problem with manual DOP. I mean, the developers or the DBAs, they can run the query with high degree of parallelism, even if my number of CPUs are less, right? It can't guarantee the same query performance every time, right? Now, what does it mean? So the problem with manual DOP is, if I run a query, right? If I run a query with say 8 parallelism, right? But say all my parallel query slaves are busy. Optimizer says, okay, this is 8, but then I need 8 parallel slaves. But since all my parallel slaves are busy, I can't consume. I have no spare parallel slaves available. optimizer will run the query in serial, right? It will run the query in serial. The moment the query starts execution, all my parallel slaves are now free, right? So as I said earlier, I can't change the degree of parallelism post execution, right? Now the query will run in serial. So with 8, if the query takes a 5 minutes, with serial it may take an hour, right? Now I have no choice. It will run in serial. This is where my auto DOP comes into picture, right? Now auto DOP will calculate the idle degree of parallelism at runtime based on some set of rules, right? It will balance the query runtime and the resource used by the query. And one of the benefit of auto DOP is that, okay, the same example, if I need eight degree of parallelism, but there are no parallel slaves available, I can queue the query. I can have the query in queue so that as soon as my parallel slaves are available, I can schedule this particular query so that it gets the required number of parallel slaves, which was not possible with manual DOP, right? So this is the advantage of auto DOP. So there are a couple of parameters with auto DOP. So finally, I'll wind up with the autonomous. Now autonomous database definitely uses auto DOP, right? So it works on Exadata. The benefit, it takes all the high availability and performance features of Exadata, which we spoke about, right? The storage indexes, the smart scan, the in-memory flash columnar at the flash cache layer, right? All the Exadata benefits, the automation, right? We have 19c introduced auto indexes. The will come out with auto partitioning as well, and auto DOP, right? So everything, I mean, less knobs. So we don't allow the customer to change any database parameters, any optimizer parameters, right? So what if, so in case of, you know, the traditional database, on-prem database, what you do is you face a problem, you have an option of changing a parameter, right? You change, so for example, you change a parameter optimizer index cost ADJ, which works fine, no issues. But what if you upgrade your database from 10G to 11G or 11G to 12G, right? And the DBA has left the job. So no one will take a chance to remove the parameter because it can have a negative impact, right? With autonomous database, we don't allow all these parameters to be changed. So for us, it is, you know, optimize the query by way of optimizer, right? We don't want you to modify the query. We don't want you to fix the query by way of any parameter or any hint, right? Everything is automatic, right? So this is the autonomous. So fine, so I'm done with the session. So I know I have overshot the time. If any queries, I would be happy to answer.